looking for truth, I found answers.
I thought I had it all figured out. Then I found purpose.
I was lost, but then I found a place to belong. I was abused, but now I'm healed.
I was in chains, but now I'm set free.
I was bitter. Then I found grace.
Good morning, everybody. Wow. I don't understand. Doesn't everybody dress for church like this? Especially on a holiday weekend? Hey, we are glad you're here today. If you're here for the very first time, my name is Wayne Murray, and I'm the pastor here at Grace. And we don't always dress like this, but we are in the middle of a series in the summer that we're calling Parables. And what we're doing is we're talking about the parables that Jesus told in the New Testament. And so each week during this time, you know, I've tried to make the parable come to life by dressing up as part of one of the characters of the story. And so, of course, we've dressed up as a farmer. Last week was, I tried to be a homeless person, but I looked more like a hipster, some people told me. All right, which I think the stock in Goodwill went up after last week's service. And so today, obviously, it's Bond, James Bond. No, it's not. Sorry, we're not doing at the movies quite yet. But today, we're going to talk about the parable of the 10 bridesmaids in Matthew chapter 25. Now, if you're taking notes this morning, and I hope you are, remember what the definition of a parable is in the New Testament. A parable is a simple story that illustrates spiritual truths or profound truths. So Jesus took things we understand or natural things to help explain supernatural things. So he took things that people in his culture understood to help them understand things that were beyond their understanding. And so today we're going to talk about Matthew 25 and the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. And of course, when I was trying to decide, hey, what do you wear when you're telling a story about a wedding? Well, or this particular parable, I had a few suggestions. Some people suggested I dress up like a prepper. Now, that's different than preppy. A prepper is somebody who's waiting for Armageddon to come. You know, they're armed to the teeth. You know, they've got military rations in their basement. Don't raise your hand if that's you, but, you know, somebody like that. One person said, you know, you could be like the militia Minuteman after all, it's the 4th of July weekend, ready in a minute's notice, you know, preparing for the return of Christ. And some people said, one particular person said, you should probably use the homeless man's outfit trying to afford the issue with those 10 women. So that, I'm not sure about that either. So they may not get the whole gist of the story. But the most common suggestion was a tuxedo. So here we go. Now someone would say, Pastor, why are you doing this? Why are you dressing up every week for these parables? Because I've got this voice in the back of my mind of a professor I had at Bible college who kept telling us it is a sin to make the Word of God boring. It's this haunting voice. Now, how many know the Word of God is not boring? Preachers make it boring. Pastors make it boring, but the Word of God is not boring. And Jesus told stories to help things come to life so that we could understand. And so we're doing the same thing here today. Matthew chapter 25, it's on the notes that you were handed out. Let's read it together. The kingdom of heaven will be like 10 bridesmaids who took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish and five were wise. The five who were foolish didn't take enough olive oil for their lamps. But the other five were wise enough, smart enough to take along extra oil. When the bridegroom was delayed, everybody say delayed. That's a big part of the story. The bridegroom was delayed. They all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, they were roused by the shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet him." All the bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. Then the five foolish ones asked the others, "Please give us some of your oil because our lamps are going out." But the others replied, "We don't have enough for all of us. Go to a shop and buy some for yourselves." Now that seems kind of mean, doesn't it? I'm going to explain what that's about in just a moment. But while they were gone to buy oil, the bridegroom came. Then those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was locked. Everybody say locked. Later, when the other five bridesmaids returned, they stood outside calling, "Lord, Lord, open the door for us." But he called back, "Believe me, I don't know you." So Jesus summarizes the parable with this one line. So you too must keep watch, for you do not know the day or hour of my return. Let's pray together. Would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, we invite you to speak to us through this parable. We pray that you would open our eyes, that we would see wonderful things in your law. Speak to every one of us who are here today, those who are watching online. We pray, God, that we would hear your voice. And God, we don't want to just hear the word of God. We want to be different. We want to be transformed. So change us today through the power of your word and the anointing of your spirit. And everybody said, amen. Amen. So Jesus uses the imagery of a wedding to explain or help understand being ready for the return of Jesus Christ to the earth. He describes it as a wedding. And more importantly, about being ready for the return of Jesus Christ. And so, because weddings are different in each culture, every culture has its own traditions when it comes to weddings. How many know that? I did a little research to illustrate this, because different cultures have different traditions when it comes to weddings, and it's interesting. For instance, in Japan, the bride is painted white, head to toe, as a symbol of her purity. And I found it interesting that every bride, or at least the tradition in Japan, is for her to wear this covering over her head. And let me read it to you so I can get this right. So that she might hide her horns of jealousy that she feels toward her mother-in-law. That can't be a good way to start a marriage. I'm just saying, all right? I'm hiding my horns of jealousy. How about this? In Jamaica, a wedding is a community affair, and everyone in the village gathers in the streets to see the bride. She would walk through the middle of the town, all the way through the town to the ceremony, and everybody in the town is encouraged to come watch and to comment upon the bride's appearance as she walks to the ceremony by herself. And you are encouraged to say whatever you think, positive and negative. Can you imagine that? Oh, that's a pretty dress. Oh, your hair's so nice.
Hey, you got too much makeup on.
You know, I mean, that's the way it is in Jamaica. And I'm thinking if people actually knew this, that might put a damper on destination weddings in Jamaica. I'm not sure about that. And then in Wales, I thought this was interesting. In Wales, they have a tradition called love spoons. And so if a man loves a woman and he wants to marry her, this is true. Look it up. I found it on the internet, and everything on the internet is true. Especially when it comes to the return of Jesus. Come on, somebody. All right. And so if a man loves a woman in Wales, he carves a spoon, his own spoon, out of wood and presents it to the woman that he loves. If she accepts the spoon, they are now engaged. It kind of gives new meaning to the word spooning, doesn't it? I just want you to know I try really hard on this stuff, all right? Then it comes to Russia. In Russia, many couples are required to take a bite out of a loaf of bread that is prepared specifically for their first meal after their marriage, okay? So they return home, somebody makes this loaf of bread, and they're required to put their hands behind their back, and so the bride takes a bite, the groom takes a bite. This is true. And the person with the biggest bite is considered to be the head of household. So follow this logic with me. Basically, the person with the biggest mouth. Okay, I'll let you finish. All right, you understand. Well, yeah, that makes sense. So if we're going to understand the proper context of Jesus' story about this wedding, we need to understand the cultural context of weddings in Jesus' time. And so I want to read to you a paragraph from a book that I've been using as a primary source for a lot of these parables. It's called Stories with Intent by Klein Snodgrass. Here's what he says about weddings in Jesus' time. He says, typically, the betrothal, or what we would consider the engagement, the betrothal took place in the bride's father's house. It was a festive occasion with blessings, food, candles, and celebration. So the engagement of the bride and the groom was a very festive occasion and always took place at the bride's father's house. During the period between the betrothal and marriage, which could extend several years, wow, the young woman remained in her father's house. When the wedding day came, after the bride was beautifully adorned and perfumed, she would be taken in a festive celebration to the groom's house. Come and go with me. Okay. I only have about 10% of you who get that, so I'll just keep going. So about nightfall, remember this story that Jesus told is about what happens at night because they're carrying lamps. About nightfall, the procession would begin, and the bride would be escorted to the groom's house by an entourage with torches and lanterns or lamps. The groom would go to receive the bride and bring her into his home where the celebration would last as long as 7 days, okay? So when we study a parable like this or we hear a story like Jesus is telling about these 10 bridesmaids, what we're tempted to do is to dig down deep into the details and the allegory and the metaphors of all of these stories. And believe me when I say there are a lot of those in this parable. I mean, the imagery that Jesus creates about a wise woman and a foolish woman mirrors Solomon's verbiage in the book of Proverbs about a wise woman and a foolish woman. It's powerful. And if you want to apply this to the nation of Israel and the people who were hearing what Jesus was saying and the difference between salvation, eternal salvation, and the salvation of Israel, and you understand that delay, there are all kinds of ways to understand this parable. So there's all kinds of stuff here. But I think this is a good time for us to be reminded of another Bible study principle, because in this series, we don't want you to just read the Bible. We want you to learn to study the Bible, okay? And we've talked about different ways to study the Bible, but today, I want to remind you of a simple Bible study principle called KISS. And I think we all know what KISS stands for. It has nothing to do with a wedding. Keep it simple. You said it, I didn't, all right? Now, what do we mean by that? In reading the Bible, the main things are the plain things, and the plain things are the main things. How many know sometimes we miss what the Bible is saying to us because we're looking down in the weeds for all of the details? And we forget what the obvious things are or what the plain things are. And remember, the Bible is not given for our information. The Bible is given for our transformation. God gives us His Word to change us, not to just inform us. And so when we approach God's Word, when we read it, we're building the habit of reading the Bible in our lives, the one-year Bible, and however you're reading the Bible, we don't approach it just to put information in our mind. We approach it as, what is God saying to me? How does this apply to me? And more often than not, it's pretty simple. How many would agree with that? And so I want to bring out three plain principles from this story. What is Jesus trying to say? What are the main things that are so obvious to all of us? And then we're going to take some time to pray together. Is that okay with everyone? Here they are. Here's the first one. I want you to write this down. What is Jesus saying in this parable? Christ, the bridegroom, will return for His bride, the church. Did you know that? Jesus Christ, the heavenly bridegroom, is going to return to the earth to get His bride, the church of Jesus Christ. Now, who's the bride, Pastor? All those who are followers of Jesus, those who have put their faith in Christ to save them. The Bible calls them the bride of Christ. And Jesus says here in verse 6, He says, at midnight, they were roused by the shout, "Look, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and meet Him." Now, the Bible later describes this thing called the rapture, where a heavenly horn will sound, a trumpet will sound. Russ Taft so eloquently sang it 100 years ago. Listen to the trumpet of Jesus, right? We're listening for that sound where it says the bridegroom is coming. And for us, that means Jesus Christ is returning to the earth for His church. And that is the next thing to happen on the prophetic timeline. Every detail, all the prophecies of Jesus have been fulfilled. The next one then is the rapture of the church. Jesus, the bridegroom, coming back for His bride, the church. Now, some would say, well, you know what, Pastor? It's kind of old-fashioned to talk about the return of Jesus. People have been talking about it for as long as we can remember. But I want to say to you, we're talking about it because Jesus talked about it. As a matter of fact, in the 46 parables that Jesus told in the New Testament, the most common topic that He addresses in the parables is His return. So this is pretty important to Jesus. Matter of fact, did you know that 24 of the 27 books in the New Testament mention the return of Jesus Christ? And the only three books that don't mention it in the New Testament are the one-chapter books. Did you know that there are 260 chapters in the New Testament, but 300 references to the return of Jesus in the New Testament? Are you getting this? The Bible has a lot to say about the return of Jesus. And so if the Bible talks about it a lot, we should talk about it a lot. If Jesus talked about it a lot, we should talk about it a lot, regardless of how cool or uncool people think it is. Matter of fact, this entire parable is about not forgetting to be ready for the return of Jesus. Now, why talk about it, can I tell you? It's because this is what separates us from the world. This is what separates you and me from everybody else, because everybody else, all they think about is the here and now. This earth, this life, this country, this situation, my world. And our minds are set on that day in and day out. What's here? What's in front of my face? But we are different. I said, you and I are different because we are not living for this life. We are not expecting a political savior to come and save us. We are looking for a heavenly bridegroom to come for his church, the bride of Jesus, and rescue us to be with him in heaven forever. And I love what one writer said. He said, the appearance of the bridegroom is the signal for the festivities to begin. Oh, I like that. The appearance of the bridegroom, it's not doom, it's not dread, it's not like, oh. No, it's a signal. The party is about to start. The celebration's about to happen. The food, the party, the celebration, the happiness, the reunion, the cry. Come on, somebody, give God praise. If you're looking forward to the day when Jesus returns. So the return of Jesus, of his church, the second main principle from this story is this, is that no one knows the day or the hour of Christ's return. And that is really the heart of this story. Jesus, the bridegroom, is returning for his bridegroom or his bride, the church. But nobody knows the day or the hour. He says in verse 13, he says, watch therefore, for you know neither the day or the hour. Now this verse is interesting because in Matthew 24 and Matthew 25, Jesus repeats this single phrase five times. And how many know when somebody repeats something five times in the course of two chapters, he's trying to get your attention. Nobody knows the day or the hour. And then later in verse 5 of Matthew 25, he says, as the bridegroom was delayed, they all became drowsy and slept. Now, Jesus in this parable gives us a warning. He says, yes, I'm going to return for the bride, but there's going to be a delay. There's going to be a waiting time. There are about 45 of us who spent most of the night in downtown Cincinnati at a street park who know what the word delay means now. Can I get a witness in the house of God? Yeah, no. We were waiting on a bus. It had broken down. Delay. But Jesus gave us a warning. How many know if somebody would have warned us that night? Never mind. And Cubs won too. It was a really bad day. So Jesus said, listen, focus, pay attention. Jesus said there would be a delay between the time that his resurrection and he ascends to heaven and when he would return for his bride, the church. And this delay, let's be honest, has been a stumbling block for people for thousands of years. That's why Peter wrote in 2 Peter chapter 3, here's what he said. He said, scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own sinful desires. And watch this. Peter is saying the reason people will criticize and the reason people will say Jesus is not coming and the reason people will say you shouldn't be talking about this is because of their own sinful desires. They don't want to be accountable. They don't want to live that way. That was free. They will say, where's the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation. Translation, people have been talking about this for a long time. But do not overlook this one fact, Peter says, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you. Here's why he's waiting. Because he doesn't wish that anybody should perish, but that all should come and reach repentance. Why the delay? I believe that God in his foreknowledge and God in his omniscience and God in his incredible understanding knows the exact day and the exact hour that the maximum number of folks will be right with God. Because God's not willing for one person to perish. So no one knows the day or the hour except God himself. And when that day comes, we must be ready. Somebody say amen. In Matthew 24, the chapter before chapter 25, Jesus says, well, let me back up. We don't know the day or the hour, but Jesus is saying we can know the season. We can know when it's getting close. In Matthew 24, Jesus gives signs of the times. He says there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. There's going to be famines and pestilences. There's going to be diseases. There's going to be false prophets and earthquakes. There's going to be people calling good evil and calling evil good. And people will depart from the faith, and persecution of followers of Jesus will increase. And I'm reading that and I'm thinking, wow, that sounds like most of the headlines we read about or see every day. See, we may not know the day or the hour, but we can know the season. And I think we would all agree that our world is getting ready for the return of Jesus. I mean, what's going on in the world anyway? Now, I'm not a prophet. I'm not a son of a prophet. And for now, this is still a nonprofit organization. We pray it continues to be that way. So I'm not speaking as saying this is prophetically what's going to happen. I'm speaking as a person with just common sense. What's ahead for us? I mean, think about it. One of two people will be the next president of the United States. And regardless of your political leanings, do you know what I see in the future? Uncertainty. Perhaps chaos. I could take time, and all of us probably could take time and say, well, this could happen, and this could happen, and this could happen. But I just want you to know, what's going on? You know, Great Britain secedes from the European Union. I mean, how dare they think that they're actually a democracy and they should rule themselves? I mean, I know, that's craziness. But what's going on? Can I tell you, Hebrews says that everything that can be shaken will be shaken, so that which is unshakable will remain. The world is shaking, and I believe preparing for a man of sin to come on the scene to restore order. He's the Antichrist, the rider of the horse in Revelation, the beast out of the sea that Daniel described a few weeks ago in the book of Daniel. What's going on? Can I tell you, we are in the season of Christ's return to the earth. We don't know if it'll be today. We don't know if it'll be tomorrow. We honestly don't know if it'll be 10 years from now. But we do know, when we look at the Bible and these signs that Jesus said and other writers of the Bible says, we can say it is getting very, very close. And it's very soon. So the parable warns us to be ready, to be prepared. And so that leads us to the third principle from this parable, which I think is very obvious to everybody. We're supposed to live with expectation of Christ's return. I think this is the primary principle of this parable that Jesus is saying. How does this affect me? What does this mean to me? Jesus is saying, you should live like you're ready. You should live every day as if Jesus Christ is coming back today. We should get up in the morning every day and anticipate or ask the question, Lord, is this the day you will return for me? He says we should live that way. And I think verse 10 is the primary verse in this parable. The five who were, say it again, the five who were, they were ready. They went in to meet the bridegroom. Who made it and who didn't? The ones who were ready, the ones who were prepared, made it into heaven. Now, Jesus calls them wise because they were ready. They were wise because they were prepared. They were expecting the bridegroom, and as a result, they were invited into the marriage feast. And he calls those who were not ready, he calls them foolish. Five were wise, five were foolish. And if we fast forward to 2016, he says some will be wise about the return of Jesus, and some will be foolish about the return of Jesus. How do you know if you're wise or if you're foolish? Jesus says the difference is, how prepared are you? You say, well, Pastor, that's a hard question. How do you get prepared for the return of Jesus? Well, I think the answer is in the parable. And I think there's two things that Jesus shows in this parable how we should prepare for the return of Jesus. And I'd like for you to write these down, but the first way that we can prepare is through prayer. Now listen closely, because I think the oil in the lamp is very important. The five wise maids. I keep making up words. The five wise bridesmaids had enough oil, and the five foolish ones didn't have enough oil. Now, we know in the Bible, what else the Bible says, that oil is a very common symbol of the Holy Spirit or his presence or anointing. Now, anointing, that word anoint means to rub, okay? So an anointing means that you were close enough to somebody for them to brush up against you or to rub off on you. And so when we talk about anointing, we're talking about being with the Holy Spirit being with us. Are you getting this? And so the bridesmaids were foolish because they thought they could get into the wedding without oil. They thought that they could be part of the wedding without a relationship with God through prayer, without rubbing up against Jesus, without spending time with Jesus. They all fell asleep, and some Bible scholars think that's a picture of death or a metaphor for death, that they all died, and then the bridegroom came. Follow the logic here. And so the five who were foolish asked the impossible of the five who were wise. They asked them for oil. Now, this parable is not meant to teach selfishness. That's not the goal of the parable. It's meant to teach the impossibility of borrowing someone's faith when it's too late. Do you get this? So they hear the most solemn words and most sobering words that anybody can hear in verse 9. And I'm reading from the Amplified Bible because Jesus makes it clear what the oil is all about. He says, I solemnly declare to you, I do not know you. I'm not acquainted with you. Listen, the reason they weren't invited into the wedding, the reason they weren't allowed into the wedding is because they didn't have a relationship with God through prayer. How many know there are some things you can't borrow from somebody else? And one of those things is a relationship with Jesus. You're not going to get to heaven on somebody else's prayers. You're not going to get to heaven on somebody else's walk with God. Oh, my parents were praying for me. Or my kids are praying for me. That's not enough. You got to know God yourself. You got to have a relationship with God yourself. This is more than just praying a prayer of magic words and writing your name on a card. God did not create you. He created you for a relationship with you. He created you to know you so that you can know him. That is his plan and his purpose for us. Come on, somebody. And one of the easiest ways to assess your walk with God is your prayer life. Do you talk to God? Does he talk to you? How many know any relationship without communication is not a relationship at all? So if we're going to be ready, the best way to prepare for the return of Jesus, listen closely, is to strengthen and prioritize your relationship with God through prayer. If I want to be ready for the return of Jesus, I got to make prayer a big part of my life. I got to grow in that area of my life. I got to make it a priority in my life. Are you getting this today? Here's the second part of this parable that I think helps us to be ready for the return of Jesus. First of all is prayer. Second of all is purity. Pastor, what are you talking about, purity? Well, the 10 bridesmaids in other translations are referred to as virgins. And it's really too bad that the word virgin has become something that people laugh about in today's culture. Because the word virgin is simply a picture of purity. And so Jesus paints the picture of purity for these people. Now listen, it's a reminder from Jesus that God's plan for us in marriage is to keep ourselves pure. Let me talk to the husbands and the wives in the room. Listen, God's plan for marriage is for you to keep your mind pure, your heart pure, your spirit pure toward God and toward one another. And whatever you have opened the door or allowed into your life that is impure, close that door, get rid of it, it will destroy you. If you're not married, perhaps you're a young adult, perhaps you're a teenager, you know you're growing up and you have this sexually charged culture and raging hormones. And can I tell you, this is a reminder to you, that God expects and wants you to be a person of purity. And remember, when God says that to you, he's trying to protect you from something. And he's trying to prepare you for something. It is always to your benefit, young person, teenager, student, it's always to your benefit to stay pure. It's always to your benefit. Everybody else may be doing whatever they're doing, maybe looking the way, whatever they're looking, maybe wearing whatever they're wearing, but listen, they're going to face the consequences of that. You make your own choice. You trust Jesus. If I keep my heart pure, my spirit pure, my body pure, I'm going to tell you, God will bless you. And I can tell you that every adult in this room will say with me, keep yourself pure. And all the adults said, amen. Amen. I've never met anybody who regretted keeping themselves pure. But I've talked to so many through tears and regret that they didn't. And thank God for the grace of God. That's the name of this church for a reason. But I believe every adult in this room would cheer on every student, every young boy, every young girl. Keep yourself pure. Amen? God's plan for his bride is to be pure. Look at what Paul describes in the book of Ephesians, chapter 5. He says, he gave up his life, talking about Jesus, for her, who? The bride. To make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. He did this to present her to himself as a glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. Look at the picture that Paul describes of the bride that Jesus Christ will return for. Holy and clean, without a spot or wrinkle. And then we should ask ourselves, does that describe us? Does that describe me? Holy and clean, without a spot or wrinkle. Jesus Christ is not coming for a bride with a torn dress, soiled clothes, messed up hair. No, the Bible says Jesus is coming for a bride that's glorious, spotless, because of the grace of God through the blood of Jesus. Is that the life that you're living? Does that describe you? Because if not today, I've got some really good news. You have time to prepare today to get your heart pure, to keep your mind pure, your spirit pure. Now, I think right before we pray, I think the most sobering aspect of this parable is that there were five foolish people, foolish enough to believe that they were ready. But they didn't know it until it was too late that they were not ready. Now listen closely, because we're about to pray. Please give me your best attention. That tells me that in the last days, there will be not a few people. There will be a lot of people who think everything's all right between me and Jesus. Everything's good because you have accepted a cultural form of Christianity that requires nothing from you. And I'm going to tell you what. Pastor, why are you telling us this? Because I love you. Because Jesus said it this way. Jesus put the parable there to warn us, because he's not willing that you perish. He doesn't want you to be surprised. He wants you to be ready. So if you're trusting in your works to save you, if you're trusting in your mom and dad's prayers to save you, or somehow you've justified the sinfulness of your own life and God understands, can I tell you, God gave you a gift today. He brought you to church to hear a very clear but powerful message that he loves you and he wants you to be ready. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? I'm going to ask that no one be moving around. Please, no one be exiting the building. But I want to ask here simply today, are you ready for the return of Jesus? Are you ready? The Bible says no one knows the day or the hour. We don't know if it'll be today. We don't know when it will be. But the Bible says, Jesus said, live like you're ready. Live with expectation. If you're here today and there is any doubt in your mind, any doubt in your heart, if you are or are not ready for the return of Jesus, I want to pray for you. I want to pray with you. And we're together, we're simply going to ask God to purify us, to wash us. And through faith, we're going to believe in the power of the cross to save us, to accept Jesus, to repent of our sin, to follow him, to serve him through the grace of God. How many are here today would raise your hand and say, Pastor, when you pray, I want you to pray for me because that's me. I want to make sure I'm right with God. I want to make sure my heart is ready. I want to be ready for the return of Jesus. How many of you would raise your hand and say, Pastor, pray for me. I want to make it right with God today. Raise your hand real high. Raise it up. Yes. Raise it up real high. Raise it up real high. God bless you. God bless you. Raise it up real high. Yes. 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 All over the room, on the floor, in the stadium. Keep it up. Yes. Keep raising them. They're still going up. Pray for me, Pastor. I want to make it right with God. Yes, yes, I need to prioritize my relationship with God and put him first. Hands are up all over the room. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you so much. Every one of you with your hands raised, I'm not going to ask you to come to the front, but I would like you to stand if you mean business with God. You raise your hand. I want to be right with God. Pastor, pray for me. I want you to stand. Take one more step, would you? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Heads are still bowed, eyes are still closed, but you're taking a stand for Jesus. I want to be ready. I want to be right. I want to serve God. If that's you and you mean business with God, would you pray this prayer with me? And everyone that would want to encourage them in this prayer, say it out loud like you mean it. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for this story.
Thank you for this story.
I want to be ready.
I want to be ready.
For your return.
For your return.
I need you, Jesus. I'm lost. I'm a sinner. I have broken your laws. I'm guilty. Please forgive me. I put my faith in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection to save my eternal soul. From this day forward, I confess Jesus is Lord of my life. Holy Spirit, fill me with your power to follow Christ every day. In Jesus' name, amen. Somebody give God praise for these many people. Praise God. Come on, don't patty cake for that stuff. The Bible says there's more joy in heaven over one. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. I'd like everybody to stand. And again, please ask that nobody be leaving if you don't mind. But every one of you that raised your hand and stood just now and prayed, I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. On your way out today, in the hub, there's a kiosk called Next Steps. And I want you to stop by there on your way out. And we're going to give you a free Bible. I want to put some resources in your hand, talk to you about what the next steps are of following Christ, because this is not a magic prayer. This is the beginning of a relationship. How to build your prayer life. We've got resources to help you. We've got a prayer book to help you to learn how to pray and grow in that things, okay? I don't want to just tell you have to do stuff. I want to show you how to do it and grow in your relationship with God, okay? So on your way out, matter of fact, Jason and bookstore folks, I'm going to go ahead and call an audible. Everybody who prayed with us today to receive Christ, let's give them all a free prayer book, okay? Just give it to them, all right? And we'll make more if we run out, but we want to grow in that area of our life, amen? Here's how I'd like to conclude today's service. I know this is it's a pretty sobering message, but how many agree? We need to hear this. We need to talk about this because we need to be ready. And I'm gonna tell you, this is a gift. It's a gift to live this way. It's a gift to know that my days are numbered. It's a gift to know that this is not going to be all there is. It's a gift to know it's not always going to be like this. There is coming a day when there's not gonna be any heartache. There's not gonna be any pain. There's not gonna be any suffering. There's not going to be any trouble. Jesus is coming. So, here's how I would like to end this message today. I'd like to open up these altars, and I want you to come and find a place to pray. If you physically can't come, then find a place to pray in your seat for a few minutes, and I want you to pray about this. Matter of fact, you may just want to pray this simple prayer. Lord, make me ready. Lord, make me ready. If God's convicting you about your prayer life, if God's, whatever God's speaking to you about, talk to Him about that. Let's take some time preparing for the return of Jesus. God, make me holy. Make me pure. Help me be strong. Are you getting this today? This is the last thing I'm going to say. When I say amen, we're going to worship, and I'm not going to come back and have a final prayer. You stay as long as you want, or if you need to go, I understand. But I think it'll be very important for us today to spend some time preparing our hearts for the return of Jesus. You agree with that today? So God, we pray.
Yes, God.
We pray, God, that you would make us ready. As a church, as individuals, as a man, God, as women, as young adults, God, we pray, make us ready for the return of Jesus. Give us a hunger for prayer. Give us a new desire for purity, victory over sin. May we live every day expecting, looking forward to your return. Amen. Let's pray. God bless you. I invite you to come and pray.
Spirit and the bride, we cry out to you.
Thank you, God.
We cry out to you. Come quickly, we long for the day. We will see your face. We long to be with you. Come, Spirit and the bride, yeah. Spirit and the bride, we cry out to you. We cry out to you. Come quick, we long for the day. We long for the day. We will see your face. We long to be with you. Come quick, breathe on us, Jesus, and breathe on us until you come.
There's a fire that can't be quenched, and a love for you as strong as death. So hear us, Lord, hear the longing of our hearts, is to be where you are and not apart. We feel you. It's all around us, oh Lord. There's a fire that can't be quenched, and the love for you is strong as death.
I see his love.